Hi, this is Lynn.
And Richard.
From WisconsinGarden.com. And today we are going to be giving you 52 garden themes for your old or new expanding garden areas.
Well, how did that come about?
Oftentimes people will ask us, well,
who are you? What, by the way, no.
What can we do in our garden? We just haven't have any ideas of what we can do to make our garden special.
Well, we've had so many people over the years, you know, ask us for ideas. You know, they're either brand new to gardening,
right,
or they're a seasoned gardener and they're still looking for something special to
do
in their garden.
Because your garden evolves as you evolve and you want to try something new or something fun, or you have seen something that appeals to you and you think, well, I maybe would like to try that. Mm-hmm. But then they forget what it was that they saw, and so we're often asked. So we would like to give you these 52 garden themes and get your inspiration going, and maybe you want to try one or more than one in your garden.
Well, you taught K through three, right?
Right, nursery school.
Nursery school.
Through three.
So I think the first one on the list is very appropriate.
It is. It would be great for a children's garden. And that's the alphabet garden, where you create a collection of plants and arrange them by alphabetical name.
So you could start with aloe, you could go all the way to zinnias.
Yes.
So it'd be really challenging, also a great class project to get the kids, maybe each student gets assigned a specific plant, right?
And does the research on that letter, and then you make a marker so everybody knows what it is.
Well, as an artist, I also consider things like an art garden, which includes focal points of the art throughout your garden, which we have several pieces.
Right, and not only could the plants be the art, but also different objects you'd add in.
Well, I think the plants really complement the artwork. You know, later on we'll talk about another form of art garden that you have to scale the plants accordingly.
Oh yeah, definitely. Then we could have a botanical garden. That's like your large gardens where you see scientific tests going on or public displays of gardens featuring different plant species. But you could have it smaller in your garden where you would control what botanical features you'd like.
And of course then you have the bottle garden,
right,
which I think is really kind of cool, especially if you don't have a lot of space, because now you can create these miniature terrarium kind of environments where you can recycle glass bottles and plastic containers as well. And again, great project for schools if you want to get involved and you don't have a whole lot of space, but maybe you've got a windowsill that you can have a garden.
Right. Well, and it's fun for the winter too when kids are looking for something, right, or you're hungry for some kind of growing garden, and you can have it with little models and little ants, insects or little dinosaurs or something inside.
Just make sure the ants don't escape.
Not live ants.
Or you'll have ants in your pants.
Not live ants.
Oh, okay.
Another one would be a butterfly garden. Last year we tried that and it was very successful. We enjoyed it. And that's where you would be featuring plants that you know are specifically going to attract butterflies and pollinators. There are many of them.
There are, really. You also have the cactus garden.
Yep.
Where you actually start featuring a genre collection of cacti and succulents, which by themselves can be gorgeous. And you know, if you're living in the Southwest somewhere, it's probably something very easily to obtain and create in a garden area.
Right, when your mom was living in Las Vegas, we loved to go on walks because people's front yards were just that. They were cactus gardens everywhere you looked. Very, very interesting.
And of course, the next kind of garden is something that you would specialize in as well.
That would be the children's garden.
Or children's fairy garden, you know, if you wanted to combine the two. But
true,
we have fairy garden as a separate category.
And that can be a fun and interactive hands-on garden to explore plants and nature, things that you can have the kids touch and smell.
Yep. And of course, you have the community garden. We have several here in the Milwaukee area. Haven't seen a whole lot out here in Brookfield.
No, but we haven't been looking.
Yeah. But again, a community garden is great because it's a common area that's shared by the community. And again, it brings people together. It gets them talking about all kinds of interactive ways that they can understand and get to know one another.
Well, and share.
And share.
Right.
Share veggies.
Somebody might want to do tomatoes and somebody else might want to do cauliflower, so you can share. Container gardens are great for people that have very small spaces to garden in. If you're living in a condo or an apartment, you can just have a tub where you can grow something, or they can be beautiful containers. I just saw one on Facebook where you actually buy a pot and you paint it with day glow paint, so at night it glows.
And you then, taking off on the container garden, you also have the container water gardens.
Yes.
Where you start adding water features to the plants
And
then you have that wonderful sound. You have, again, you're dealing more with the senses.
Put a little fountain in there and it goes.
Absolutely.
Cottage gardens are very beautiful, and you see a lot of them in Europe. And the cottage garden would be a free-flowing, just colorful, pretty much totally covering an area with plants of different types that blossom all summer.
Yeah, you think of the English cottage gardens, and you know, they're delightful.
Yep.
And of course, then we have our garden, which we call an eclectic experimental garden, because basically it's really a diverse environment with a wide range of plant species. So it's not a formal garden by any stretch of the imagination. We come across plants.
It's Christmas again.
We have a clock going in the background. So
and a bird. Clock.
Yeah, BB, we hear you. That's fine. So they're part of the eclectic experimental garden
too. That's right. That's right. And the edible garden. That's a tasty one. That's where you would grow vegetables and fruits and fruit trees. Things that you can actually eat as you go out and visit.
Yeah. And as we mentioned, with the children's garden, you might want to specialize in a fairy garden where you really are dealing with a miniature environment that has scaled living plants and objects and structures, you know, that make it kind of like a little environment. And there are all kinds of things available to purchase.
So cute.
And if you go to rummage sales, you'd be amazed at what you can find in the children's section that make beautiful accent.
Or little knickknacks that people have, little glass sculptures. Those are really cool. The next one would be ethnic gardens. Now, when you're thinking, well, you go to like Janesville Rotary Gardens, you'll see they have an Italian garden or a French garden or an English garden or Japanese garden. So you could have not only one little area for like an English garden, but over here you might have something from Africa, or over here you might have something from France. So it's just do your research and figure out what plants are more related to that country.
And then you have feng shui, where maybe we're not sitting in the right position to each other. You know, it's a garden that specifically, it's really an ancient art of specific plant placements, you know, that are very soothing, very relaxing. You know, it really accents your life.
Right, and it kind of gives a direction to your life. Many people are familiar with flower gardens, and everyone loves to have flowers. You can start those flowers early in the spring with bulbs, and then just follow through, and the purpose is to get something that's blooming all summer long, so you always have color or interest in texture, and you have something for the pollinators and the hummingbirds and everybody as you enjoy the colors.
And who doesn't love flowers?
I know.
So, and of course, then you have the formal garden. Well, as we know, that's a really a very specific design, plan, or layout where you have plants in a specific pattern or design. And again, it becomes a very structured way of gardening.
Fountain garden. This is where perhaps you decide you'd like to put a fountain in your yard, big or little, and then you arrange your plants around the fountain, either in a formal setting or more wild and exciting garden around your fountain.
Well, then you have the hanging garden. And with that, you know, you're using a lot of creative sculptures or structures You know, whether it's off of beams that are on your balcony, maybe you have certain shepherd hooks that are in your yard where you're going to hang these interesting containers just with cascades of flowers and plants, maybe even vegetables, you know, depends on what you want to hang and grow.
Remember that one garden we saw where they had beams put up along the way and they grew gourds on these beams and the gourds hung down. It was really special.
I wanted to go play a rhythm on them, you know.
Yeah, really.
Kind of cool.
Herb gardens.
Isn't it herb?
Herb's not here.
Oh, okay.
You can have an herb garden in a pot. I mean, herbs are just so easy to grow. They like to be neglected. They don't need special soil. They love to just grow. As long as you have some sunny space, you can have as many herbs in there as you want, and some of them are perennial, even in zone 5, like ours.
Well, then you have the historic garden. Now, we worked with a Stagecoach Inn,
right,
and they did the research of the specific plants and vegetables that were being grown on that property to at that specific time in history.
Right.
So again, that can be a research project for a school or even for an individual who has a specific time in history that they have a passion for, and then it's trying to recreate that history in your own yard.
It's just keeping out the flowers that you love that maybe weren't growing back then.
True.
Let's have them over here. a labyrinth garden. Now, people love corn mazes in the fall. For Halloween, yeah, it's kind of scary. But you could have a labyrinth garden in your own yard using either bushes that you keep trimmed or plants and just pathways that make an interesting winding walk.
And it could be miniature, too. You know, it depends on what you want.
Sure.
Of course, the moss garden is a whole other thing. Now, we had the opportunity to visit a spectacular moss garden last summer
in Waukesha.
Mm-hmm. Just amazing, because really you're specializing in sustainable colonized moss species that, you know, create an accent often with rocks and other features that make it so inviting.
Right.
And he had built into a landscape, a hill.
Wonderful.
It was magnificent.
Elephant ears and hostas, and it was wonderful. I hope he has another tour.
And where were we this week?
Just tell me, where were we?
Well, we were at the native plant garden, you know.
We were on the prairie, yes. And we have the native plants for your area. The native plants, once they are established, you don't have to worry about them. They will grow themselves. You just, usually you have to have a kind of a bigger space for them because they do take up space. But they also improve your soil because the roots go down so deep that they bring up nutrients to the top of the soil where they've been missing for a long time, because maybe you've had grass or you've used up the nutrients in your garden. These native plants will bring those nutrients back up to the surface.
And you might be amazed at the variety of native plants in your given area that you never even thought of
like
adding
the
to your garden.
Plants. Those compass plants.
Just came up, by the way.
I know, I saw it. It was so exciting.
And then you have the organic garden. Well, that's basically gardening without using synthetic fertilizers and pesticides and herbicides. So you're really working with compost and the soil and keeping it very rich and natural and avoiding all those artificial elements.
And oftentimes, in order to prepare an organic farm, they grow native plants on the land for several years to, like I said, help bring those nutrients back up. So it's a very important way of growing, and people are becoming more aware of eating organically without chemicals. Pathway garden. This would be kind of like a labyrinth garden, but you would just have pathways that maybe wind through. Maybe you already have a garden, but you don't get to see some of the plants that are in the back, so you just kind of make yourself a pathway to go in there and see all the different aspects of your garden.
Or like the prairie garden that we visited, they go through the woods, so that path can actually meander off of a property and into another property.
Sure.
Or connecting with neighbors, depending on what you want
right.
to do.
Right, that would be nice.
Yeah. And then, of course, you have the rooftop garden, which we're seeing more and more of in the city.
Yes.
Rather than have, you know, a hot roof, you now have a structure, first of all, strong enough to support the garden. But now you're growing vegetables, you're using rainwater, you're not having all that runoff and everything. And so you're really getting to use a lot of space that normally was pretty much wasted space.
Right. A cutting garden is another one, especially for flowers. That would be a great one to combine with container gardening, because these are going to be flowers, perhaps they have a little bit longer stem, that are known to last for a longer time when you cut them. Lots of varieties of plants. You just, when you're looking them up or getting them at your garden center, be sure to ask, are these flowers that are going to last when I cut them? Are they going to make a nice display?
Yeah. And of course, then you have the succulent garden. You know, you're specializing in leafy, thick plants that retain water, or in some cases, sap, which is where the word originally came from.
Mm-hmm. Philosophy garden. Now, this would be a very interesting garden to be in. It would be a place where you create spaces in your garden.
To think or not to
think. And to meditate and just maybe just be peaceful and relax.
That would be unique. Of course, then you have a pond garden. I mean, that's what we started with, a tiny little container, so to speak, a large container that was on sale, and we thought, let's just sink it in the ground and have some fish and have a water feature. And it was so pleasant, and it inspired us to do a waterfall later on.
Yes.
So plant gardens, or pond gardens rather, are really a super water feature garden that specializes, and then you find plants that go with it too.
So. And it attracts other little species.
Yeah.
Prairie gardens. Now, we were just visiting our prairie garden that we have been fortunate enough to find. Probably you need a little extra space for a prairie garden, because the plants seem to be larger, they take up a lot of space, but once they get settled, and once they get used to the layout, let me start that over. I didn't look up. Prairie gardens. Now, we have been fortunate enough to find a prairie garden that we can go and visit, and every time we go out there, we find something that we hadn't seen before. We learn something new about these native plants that grew on the prairie.
And grasses,
right. They grew on the prairie all by themselves, and were just so adaptive to whatever conditions were there. Once they're established, you really don't have to do too much, except that you probably want to keep adding more and more.
Right. And of course, you have the rain garden. Now, that, you know, you hate to talk about trendy kind of things, but we've noticed that everywhere we go, the clubs, the organizations are looking at new ideas again.
Right.
And oftentimes we hear that rain garden, you know. I think it's, first of all, it's wonderful. We saw it at the prairie because it's a way of really creating a sunken area that will contain or hold water runoff, so that it's a great way, rather than just having it go down a sewer or something on your property. You have a lower area that's specifically with a lot of rocks and plants and things like that, kind of as a storage area for
water.
Right,
it keeps the rain in your on your property rather than letting it go to waste, raised bed gardens.
Yeah. Now, well, we have 27.
There are many of those. It's just where you actually make a bed that is above the ground level using 2x4s or straw bales.
I probably use 2x12s, not 2x4s.
Yeah, true.
That'd be a pretty tiny little raised bed. I mean, it might work.
Miniature one.
Could be.
Or people can sometimes use tires. I mean, you can use anything that mounds up the dirt and
a raised bed.
Right.
It's above ground.
And if you don't have soil that's very good, you can add lots of nutrients into your bed and keep more control over it that way.
And, you know, again, with the rain garden, you have the rock garden. So again, if you have a rocky terrain, yeah, or you want to bring in some rocks, you know, and have a special kind of feature where maybe on a hillside, you know, you don't want the erosion to take place, so you start strategically adding rocks and then finding plants that will complement that.
Little sedums work great for there. Yeah. And even we have cactuses that grow in Wisconsin.
And I mean, we have moss.
Yeah,
so
we do. So it could be a wet one or a dry one. Another one would be a sculpture garden. Let's say you were blessed to be presented with a sculpture, or you are an artist and you've created a sculpture, and you want to make a garden that goes with the sculpture, maybe repeating the lines of the sculpture, or
well, you don't want to be overbearing where you're distracting and taking away from the artwork. So you're looking for plants that are going to complement the scale of the artwork itself.
True.
So then you have what I love is a sensory garden, because dealing with children, especially, and adults too, it's interesting and challenging to get them thinking about how things feel. I mean, touching a succulent plant and a flower, or you know, anything else, whether it's wood and having wind chimes so that you get the auditory sound, the birds,
the
smell of the flowers. So you're dealing with all the senses and trying to create a garden that really focuses on all six senses.
And don't forget the little mimosa where you touch it and it closes up. Right. That's always fascinating for the kids. What is my next one?
The shade garden.
Thank you. The shade garden. Many people have trouble with their yards because they have very tall trees and they have shade all the time. And they say, well, what can we possibly grow in the shade? Well, there are not only hostas that grow in the shade, ferns, moss, of course, but there is a whole variety. If you just type in the word shade garden plants, you will find a wide variety of plants and even flowers that like to grow in the shade.
And deer resistant.
Some of them are, yes. Yeah.
And then, of course, you have the specialty garden, because if you want to represent a very special type of plant or a design or a layout, now you can specialize in something that you're personally passionate about.
Yeah.
So,
how about a tea garden? I would love to
Is it time for tea already?
I would love to have a tea in
the
garden.
Tea and crumpets?
And I always think of Tea House August Moon, where, you know, that's a building specifically for
I that. Actually saw the original Tea House August Moon
there
when I was on Okinawa.
Did you have tea there?
No.
You don't like
I didn't.
Tea.
It was a restaurant, and I'm not a tea drinker, so.
But it could be just you could combine it with a philosophy garden or whatever, and just have a little space in your garden where you could set up a table and then just enjoy tea.
Well, it's really meant as a place to share refreshments. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, again, like the philosophy garden or the thematic garden, it gives you a chance to rest, relax, and enjoy the company of others, or even yourself reading a good book.
Yeah, and you could drink coffee there too.
Yep. And of course you have the terrace garden, because many of the properties that we visit, a lot of people say, well, you know, I've got these hills in my backyard, I don't know what to do. Well, then, you know, you might want to consider terracing. In other words, cutting back a flatter area of land, kind of like steps going into a hill.
Sure. Then there's the therapy garden.
Oh, I need it.
Many healthcare centers are now incorporating gardens right around their facilities. Well,
especially the hospitals
here.
I mean, they have specific gardens designed to, again, give people that sense of being and the calmness and the feeling of serenity. So
very peaceful and therapeutic.
And of course, we like to replicate the tropical garden, because you love elephant ears.
I do.
You know.
Well, and then there's hibiscus and all.
Well, you've got these lush, exotic plants that, unfortunately, here in Wisconsin, we can't always grow.
Right.
But we do the best to maybe start them in the house, you know, and then get them out and hopefully bring them in before the frost comes.
Now, maybe you don't have a lot of horizontal room to grow in, but you could have verticals, and you could use trellises for that.
Vertical gardening is becoming very
Very much so. Or you could use a wall and add pots to it, or
well, even
or
if
flower
you
boxes.
Even if you do have space, you still get to grow so much more, and
yes.
it's so much easier to pick. I think of the gourds that you grew and the
right.
squash.
Well, tomatoes.
And tomatoes, I mean, yeah, you have rings.
It gives you a lot more room for many things because you're growing up, not just having to spread out.
And of course, you really have the victory garden. This was before your time.
Oh, yes.
I remember it, but you don't, you know.
I was just a baby.
You know, it's a way of producing more food on the home front. And the Victory Garden was really developed during wartime when the government really encouraged you to grow your own garden.
Yes.
And I think many of us are going back to that type of situation where we want to grow heirloom plants so that we can grow vegetables and seeds.
Well, you want to know exactly where your food is coming
yeah,
from.
That's important. Yeah.
Yes. One of the ways to grow a garden if you don't have a lot of space is a wall garden. And that would be wonderful for plants that really like heat if you're yeah. doing it on the south side. But you could use it on any of the sides. Just making sure that the flowers and the plants that you have in pots or maybe on trellises are suitable for that type of climate so that
well,
they don't get
I think
overheated.
A great movie, by the way, this is a shout out for Peter Sellers' last movie called Being There. He is a gardener, Chauncey, and he is working in a walled garden.
True.
And so it's really a funny movie. I think it's definitely one of my favorites and something that you should see. Glenna, we all know water is such a peaceful environment to have, although having a water garden can require some upkeep because
right.
you want to have fish that keep the mosquitoes down
right.
like we do here, especially in Wisconsin and many other states that have mosquitoes. So, you know, having a water garden is just such a special feature, and it really is great for the native wildlife too. You know, it's a
oh,
place
yes.
I mean, we've had egrets,
we
you
have.
Know, we've had ducks, we've had
bullfrogs.
Yeah, I mean, it's great.
It is, it's wonderful.
Yeah.
And kind of goes right along with that, it would be a waterfall garden. Yeah. If you like the sound of water dripping or falling, a waterfall, that they now have little kits that you can create waterfalls in even small spaces, even
right.
in tubs and things that you can create a waterfall effect.
Well, I know some people have them in their businesses. I mean, you
sure.
sit
right
in
on
a
your
lobby
desk.
Or, you know, some are small enough where they
right.
sit on
sure.
a desk just to have that peaceful, wonderful, relaxing sound.
It is.
And of course, you have the wildflower garden. Well, I mean, you know, this is really an ecological environment filled with wonderful wildflowers and native grasses. Again, you know, trying to get back to a time where we didn't have a whole lot of urban sprawl where all you see are houses. Well, you know, can you imagine, you know, the subdivisions that you sometimes see? It's just house, house, house.
Right.
No trees, no flowers, no nothing. Just, you know.
Yeah.
It's kind of a sterile environment in which
right.
to live. So having plants, you know, any kind of plants are going to make life
definitely.
A lot more interesting
definitely.
And healthier.
Yeah, especially if you're going to grow trees, but they're not big enough yet.
Right.
Woodland gardens are for, again, maybe a shady area. Maybe you have trees or a little wooded area that's attached to your yard. Again, you can make pathways through there and just create some lovely little missions of places that
crannies.
You can get out of. Yes, and there are many plants, again, that grow in woods. Mayflowers, I'm thinking, and trilliums, all sorts of plants that are native to woodland mm. areas.
Well, think of all the people who go hiking just
sure,
to see
just
what's
to see.
Growing in nature.
Right.
I mean, it's nature is going to win. Regardless of what we do, nature will always win out.
Yeah.
And probably the last on our list of 52 garden themes is something most people probably aren't overly familiar with, and it's called xeriscaping. Actually, zero with an X. So, you know, we'll have that list for you. But anyhow, it's really dealing with drought-tolerant plants that grow in a specific zone And so again, like in Las Vegas as an example, there are subdivisions where you cannot grow things without getting permission.
Right.
They'll give you a specific list of drought tolerant plants.
Right.
Because they, you know, have to be very water conscious.
Water, right.
And Californians too, with
right.
the recent drought, I know they've had a lot of rain lately in some of the areas the drought warnings are done, or at least in the cautious zone at this point. But you know, we have to consider water as perhaps will be, if not already, obviously, the most important element besides air. I mean, if you think about the basics, what we all need air, we all need water, we all need food. So those three elements are part of every garden that you're going to have. And we, as stewards of the land, have to do our best in taking care of what we do.
Right, right. And that can be a beautiful thing.
Yeah.
You can create beautiful yards.
Well, I think of the gentleman that brought you to tears, that sent you that beautiful letter from the
yes.
war-torn area in Russia and, you know, Uzbekistan and that whole thing. You know, Lynn's crying like a baby, and after I read what he read, I'm crying like a baby. So, you know, the thoughts and the comments that our
yes.
wonderful viewers leave us.
We thank you
just
so
amazing.
Much. We enjoy
Incredible.
Reading comments every single day. It's yeah. a highlight of our day. We look forward to
yeah.
seeing what people have shared, because you gardeners are just so thoughtful and loving and sharing that it's a blessing for us.
I've seen both of us commenting when we comment to somebody. One of the things I've noticed in today's world, especially online, how negative people can be and bullying and this and that. But I am absolutely blown away by the kind consideration of gardeners who just, I mean, I think you had that one negative comment that one time.
That
and
wasn't
Tim,
even negative.
We know who did it. And
it was fun.
And you don't fix your hair with an egg beater.
No, I don't.
You stick it in.
Not too often.
An electrical outlet. But anyhow, Tim's been a great supporter of WisconsinGarden.com
hey,
as well. Thanks, Tim.
If you enjoyed this video and maybe got some ideas of maybe what you would like to try in your garden, mm-hmm. please give us a thumbs up. It helps support our Wisconsin Garden blog, and we would love to hear what's going on in your yard and in your garden. Yeah. We've put this on our website.
Well, I actually posted the poster that we've created on our website, right. WisconsinGarden.com, and it will look like this. It'll be unreadable when you see it, but if you click on it, it will enlarge and is very readable. And I thought it'd be kind of a fun thing to just show the 52 different garden ideas, the themes that you might want to consider for your garden or next garden.
You may come up with some of your own that you might like to share with everybody.
Oh, and if you have a theme that you feel we haven't properly covered or maybe even included, we'd love to hear it.
Sure.
Maybe the next video we do will have 100 garden themes or 1,000 garden themes. It all depends on you.
Thank you very much. If you'd like to join our garden family, please subscribe.
Yeah.
Bye for now.
Connect with us on YouTube.